what I now have shown you is the morning form of the Taijiquan 13, Wurang Taijiquan 13. Morning form Taijiquan 13 is in itself is of course a short form, and it allows to really practice the purpose and the method of Taijiquan properly. The slowness of the Taijiquan is actually based on the slowness of the rising of the sun, because the first exercise, opening yang, is actually the rising of the sun, the rising of the yang of the sun. And that moment you just have to experience a few times. That's why also, to be on the safe side, I added a video which shows you a sequence of the rising of the sun on the Vlieland, in the island in the north of the Netherlands, at the Beihai, the North Sea. When you go through the movements like that, you start noticing that the sequence of the opening exercise in itself activates the three different dantian. It starts of course with the lower dantian, and at the moment when you go more high, you open up the middle dantian, and then you go up and you go all the way to the upper dantian, and then from there you reactivate again the middle dantian. The Chinese characters are clearly based on the outline of movements of people, and this is also very helpful as an idea towards the different exercises and different characters when you're learning how to write them. The learning program from Taijiquan 13 is very clear. The idea is very simple. Through the short sequence of 13 movements, you learn basically everything that you need to learn about Taijiquan 13. You appropriate all the skills and all the knowledge and all the other details that are required to make a good form and to make good principles manifest in your movements. I have to check a little bit where I walk, because I walk here on the brush. The reason why we started with the Taijiquan 13 is because it is a form that is meant for everybody, whether you're ill or whether you're healthy or whether you're a beginner or an experienced person. Everything is in there. And as you see in the movements that I showed just now, is that when I activate the movement, the yang movement, then you see that when opening the dantian, in effect the lower dantian, the yangqi, is opening, just like the rising of the sun. The rising of the sun is basically the example for how the yangqi should be exercised from the dantian. Then at the moment when the arms are being widened, when the yangqi is opening and the palms are being left up, then you see that the middle dantian is being opened and activated, so that there is space for the heart to perceive the things as they are. And at the moment, it doesn't mean that you're going to be very full of feelings. If you're going to be very full of feelings and you feel like a bliss coming up and stuff like this, then basically you do it wrong. This is the recognition of the mind. That's a very self-oriented practice which belongs to Buddhism, not to Taoism. I just pointed out as a discernment. The bliss feeling in the heart is in Taoism considered as a fire, and the fire eventually consumes the mind. So when the mind looks too much to itself, it consumes itself. And one of my own teachers, he was a victim of that, in the sense that he had the end of his life, because of all the meditation that he did, he basically lost his mind, and he vanished. He started to become crazy. And then people said, like, following him is following crazy wisdom. It's not following crazy wisdom, it's a radical Buddhism. It doesn't mean that it is bad necessarily, but you need proper training to guide that. For this you need a proper teacher. And in Taijiquan, the opening of the heart in Taoism and in Confucianism also similar. The idea is that the heart should be empty, because it's the mirror in which you see things reflected. So everything you see, everything you eat through your eyes, your nose, your mouth, your ears, everything that comes in basically is filling the heart. And if it's pollution, because it's aggressive, it's violent, it's pornographic, it is dirty words that you're speaking, or anything else that has to do with that, and it doesn't make any sense, it doesn't really contribute to improvement of yourself towards a more perfect state of being, then at that moment it is basically polluting the heart. And the whole point of practice is to clean your heart, so that gradually you come to understand how great you can be, or how great you actually are, when everything inside you is in the right place. Well, then from opening the heart, then at that moment you lift up your arms and you collect the yang qi above your head. But in fact, what you're doing at that moment, you're activating the upper dantian, and then the three dantians have to still be aligned. So at the moment when you bring the yang qi down, go back to the lower dantian, you align the three dantians. At the moment when you actually close, you also start feeling that the middle dantian is reopening. So this is the second stage in which the opening of the middle dantian takes place. But of course, you don't feel that the first time, and you shouldn't pay attention to it like, oh, is this really happening? Is this really happening? No, you should really very calmly allow yourself to have these feelings come about you at a certain point. So through diligent practice, meditation, and the other parts that we are also all do in the Daoland program, you will gradually come there. And it depends a lot on your life experience, if that will be fast or not fast. It depends also on how good you are in not fooling yourself. And you might think of yourself that you're going to be a very rational person, or that you're a realistic person, you see everything as it is. You might be mistaken. Take for instance the example of rational science. Rational science is a movement. You have rational science and you have liberal science. Liberal science is where people are willing to investigate new things that are not proven by science, just to prove or to disprove them. Like a pure skeptic, he's a rational scientist, and as a result of that, they're not open-minded enough to actually consider the idea that something that they don't accept. And as a result of that not accepting, they're science doesn't change. It's a monolithic structure, and this monolithic structure basically freezes in a particular kind of model, and as a result of the freezing in this model, it cannot grow. It can enlarge its eye on the details of what it already knows, but it cannot come to new things. It is not innovative. And the thing is, I don't like innovation when it is disruptive, but I do consider innovation a very important part, because every person goes from birth to cradle, I don't remember the saying. It is from birth to death anyway. Every person from birth to death goes to different stages of discovery, and this discovery shows itself in, for instance, reading a book when you're 25 and then reading it again when you're 50 or when you're 80 or something like this. You will read different things in the book at that time. And that is one of the pities of modern science and modern life that goes through phones and computers and stuff like this, because rereading is not necessarily an option. And also the same, or it takes place in a novel, but in a science book, or in a book which is more philosophical in nature, you find this even more strongly, because books like that, they force you to think about things. And if you are forced to think about things, it takes time to digest, and you don't know how fast it is. You can be very smart in your mind and you can make very quick solutions, but it doesn't mean that you understand what it is. And I always take the example of my translation of the Tao Te Ching when I met Abbot Zhang in Qingshan in China near Chengdu. And my sister Tian Lifang tell her I am translating the Tao Te Ching. She was very proud of her brother doing these kind of things. She's still very young at that time. And she just started laughing. And at the moment when she started laughing, really like, ha 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 ha. She was just showing us some simple things before, like how you can use tea to brighten your eyes and to moisten your skin and stuff like this. Very interesting. But she started laughing and she said, like, she pointed to me, she said, how do you think with your Chinese, that you can translate the Tao Te Ching. There is no foreigner who can translate the Tao Te Ching. There's not even Chinese people who can translate the Tao Te Ching. There is Taoists who spend their whole life just studying one sentence to comprehend it in their whole life. So after their whole life, they only comprehend one sentence, one sentence, one sentence. That was such a shock. After that, I never dared to translate the Tao Te Ching anymore. I had already translated the I Ching, and I'm scared to recognize all the mistakes that I made. And there's, of course, a lot of mistakes, because every translation is an interpretation. And it's for you too. When you learn to do this Tai Chi Chuan in this way, you learn to do this Tai Chi Chuan in this method that I show you in this course, you will deviate eventually. Yeah, you should deviate eventually, because you should make it your own. You shouldn't copy me exactly. You should just try to do as I do, and then from there develop your own understanding so that it can become your own Tai Chi Chuan. If you want to become a teacher in Tai Chi Chuan, that's another story. Yes, but as a person, you have to eventually deviate. But first you have to learn to do it in the right way, so that the preconditions that are required to understand the Tai Chi Chuan can take place over time. Right, not immediately, but over time. So in learning the form, you go do much faster. If you follow the classes, the weekly classes, you see you go much faster. There's even a moment in the course that you're going to learn to do the Tai Chi Chuan as quickly as possible, really, like very quickly. Yeah, but that is not the time yet, and that is not learning the Tai Chi Chuan properly. This is just to learn to apply it as a wushu. But at the moment when you really learn to apply it as Tai Chi practice, that means Tai Chi in action, polarization in action. Then at that moment, you start realizing, like, this is what is meant within Tao. This is the sunrise, this is the yang rise, and this is how it is applied in your different moves. And this is why Li O always says, Tao is fragile. The Qi of Tao is fragile. You can't force the Qi of Tao. I will show you also how to learn Fa Jing. You saw in this form the practice of Fa Jing in form, and we will bring it to the right kind of applications that you need to do it right. And I must admit, I found myself partly on the teachings of Master Liu, Master Yao, and Master Shun. So these are three different teachers that I take as an example where I learned from to do this in the right way. And I will explain to you also the differences of the different methods and why the combination of the different methods is great. So on the basis of this video, I hope this was nice, and thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.